Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
The Son's dying words to the world, words spoken through pain and great suffering, with passionate love to the ones He was dying to save, are the sum of His life and works, His gift to us, His heart, and the sound bites of God.
How are you today? Well, the greatest lesson that God will ever teach us is how to love. That's His goal. He wants us to learn how to love like He loves, to love Him, to love other people as ourselves, and that's the purpose of life. Sometimes people miss the purpose of life. It's not about making money. It's not about retiring. It's not about having some fun and then eventually dying. If you don't learn how to love, you miss the purpose of life. So God is committed to that. And we are, during this Lenten season, going from the beginning of Lent and through to Easter, we're just thinking about reflecting on the seven statements that Jesus said on the cross. We're calling them sound bites because they're short. Sound bites from the cross. He said seven things. If you look at the Gospels and line them up, we're doing them in order. And we saw the first week, this is week three, the first week we saw Jesus offering the sound bite of forgiveness. He says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And then the second week, we saw Him give a sound bite of assurance to somebody who wasn't sure about his eternal destiny. He gets right with God and He gives him assurance, and He says, today you will be with me in paradise. Now, the soundbite we're going to look at today from the cross is a soundbite that is about love. It's about expanding our love bandwidth. So whatever capacity we have, God wants it to be more. We can't do it without His help, certainly. I mean, the things we're going to look at that come from this soundbite today are impossible on our own. You can't do it. I can't do it. None of us can. Because God's love is beyond what we can do, humanly speaking. It's impossible. However, with His power, if we rely on Him, we look to the Holy Spirit to empower us, to anoint us, to open up our eyes, to see things, and we can do a lot better. We can expand our love bandwidth is what we're going to talk about. And so the soundbite we're going to look at is Jesus is on the cross, and His mother and His best friend, His disciple, the Apostle John, is at the foot of the cross. And He whispers something. He speaks something to them. Now, let me give you some background. The background is Jesus is exhausted. He's tired. He's been up 24 hours. And the last several hours, He's been in six sham trials. Three by the Romans, three by the Jews. They were at night. They were illegal. You weren't allowed to do a night trial, and they're trying to push Him through. They're falsely accusing Him, and then when they finally accuse Him and through the whole process, they're beating Him, they're pulling out His hair, ripping out His beard just to be mean to Him. They put in a crown of thorns into his head. And then they scourge Him, and the scourging is a whipping, but it's not like a normal whipping. It's with a cat of nine tails. Each whip has these multiple lacerations, nine different. So every time they're struck, you have all of these lacerations. And the Jews had said, in the Old Testament, said you can't get any more than 40 lashes. So it's 39 usually is what you got. But he wasn't scourged by the Jews. He was scourged by the Romans. So they would have gone well beyond that. So he had anywhere between 300 and over 1,000 scars all over his body. Massive blood loss. He had to then carry his own cross. He's stumbling, going up a hill, going outside of Jerusalem to this place called the Skull. And then he is crucified. He's onto this cross on his hands and his feet. And as he's up there, he can barely breathe because of the positioning of the body and all what he's gone through. And then he sees his mother and his, as I said, his disciple John down there. And this is the scene that we're kind of stepping into as we read this passage that we're exploring. There in John 19, verse 25, he says, near the cross of Jesus stood his mother. Now that's Mary. His mother's sister and Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. So we're not sure exactly how many Marys there are. There's anywhere between, you know, four, maybe even more, maybe six Marys, because Mary is such a common name. When Jesus saw his mother there, she's standing at the foot of the cross, and the disciple, that's John, whom he loved, standing nearby, he said to his mother, and this is the third soundbite from the cross, dear woman, here is your son, and he's motioning to John, and to the disciple. Now, John's writing about himself, and whenever he talks about himself in this gospel, he just calls himself the disciple, because you know, he's humble. He doesn't want to brag about himself. So he says, calls himself the disciple. And to the disciple, here is your mother. And from that time on, the disciple, that's John, took her into his home. Now we know by this time that Mary had been a widow for a while now. So she's a widow. Joseph had died a while ago. And Jesus is giving instructions for his disciple to care for his mother. And then tradition says that she lived another 12 years beyond that, and that John did care for her for a while in Jerusalem. Eventually they moved to Ephesus, and John built her a house, a stone house, outside of what is now ancient Ephesus in Turkey. Sharon and I visited there a few years ago. There's a couple pictures we took. This is a first century house, and tradition goes way back saying this was Mary's house where she lived her final years. There's really no other homes there, the other ones were made of wood, so they would have just deteriorated over the years, but this one is still there, and it's been, so you can see some photos of us to prove we were there, you know. So Jesus is on the cross, and he looks down, and he says this to, you know, his mom. He sees her, and he says, this is your new son, and then to the disciple, this is your mother. Now, this could seem like an unimportant phrase, but Jesus never says things that are unimportant. Everything has meaning, and we really can learn a lot about expanding our love bandwidth through this exchange, through what happened here. And we just see God's amazing concern for people in pain, people in trauma, even though he had a lot going on himself. So we can learn about how to love like Jesus and how Jesus cares about us, even when we're in pain. And I want to just say, without Christ, this is impossible. So depending on the Lord's power, we can grow in this area. Let's look at four ways. Number one, caring for our own family. When we love like Jesus, it means we care for our own family. In the middle of all of his pain, he still notices his mother. He calls her by name. He honors her. He provides for her practical need. He provides for her emotional support. Let's look at each one of these. First of all, he's paying attention to her. He pays attention to her. You see, there's something very powerful when you look at somebody, when you pay attention to them, when you give your undivided attention. That's more meaningful than money. It's easy to just give somebody some money, but when you give them your attention, you're giving them part of your life. You can't get that back. You can always get more money. You can't get your life back. So you give your life. When my kids were little, they liked me to give them my undivided attention. Sometimes I would try to divide it. I'd be reading the newspaper back in those days, you know, a real newspaper, or on my computer. Daddy, 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 and and finally they grab my face sometimes and look at me, you know, they want my attention. And there's, because what does it say? It says, you matter to me. You're important. It's a way of loving on somebody. So you imagine this scene at the cross here, all the stuff going on, and there's crowds there, people are yelling, there's all kinds of stuff, and you can almost get this image of Jesus kind of like locking eyes with his mother. And she sees him, he's dying on the cross, and he sees her, and it's kind of like, that's, you almost, for this moment, it's like Nobody else matters. Nobody else is around. They're just looking at each other, and they're communicating probably more than just what the words are. There's community, you know, he's paying attention. He's honoring her. You know, it's interesting that John's the only disciple there. It's because the other ones are afraid for their life. And he's there. All the women are there. The women can be there a lot easier because in that day, in that culture, women were not important. Women were like, they couldn't vote. They had no rights. They were like property. And so the guards didn't even care. They didn't care women were around there. But Jesus cared, and Jesus honored. Jesus always elevated women, always. And here he speaks to his mom, honors her, speaks to her, and elevates her. Exodus 20, verse 12 says, "Honor your father and your mother." So Jesus certainly is following this command. This command is to everyone. This is to us. It's the only command in the Ten Commandments that has a promise attached to it. And it's not conditional. See, sometimes we look at that and we go, well, yeah, but my parent, you know, my dad, or you know, he wasn't even around. How can I honor him? Or you see, or they will say, you know, his moral behavior was terrible. You see, when he's talking about honoring your mother and your father, it's not talking about honoring their parenting skills. You see, God used them to create you. He used their DNA to make you. This only way you could be you is with your parents. And so you honor your parents, not about their parenting skills, not about their moral behavior. There's no term on it. It's not like, well, you have to honor them when you're in third grade, but when you move out, you don't have to do it anymore. No, I mean, it's honoring your parents. Then Jesus also met practical needs of his mother, and that's one of the ways that we love. And Jesus, this is almost like his last will and testament. His mother, as I said, is, you know, she's a widow. She's poor, and as a firstborn, he would have been his job to take care of her. He can't. He doesn't have anything anyways. He doesn't have anything to pass on. All he has is the clothes on his back, which isn't very much. And so he cares for her by entrusting her care to his best friend, the disciple John. He says, John, you take care of her. It's interesting to me, I just want to say as almost a side note, that Mary is, you know, she's a great woman. She's a godly woman. The Bible says she's a righteous woman, but she's not God. And so when she's in need, Jesus is meeting her needs. Jesus doesn't pray to her. Jesus is actually meeting her needs because he's going to know she's going to have many needs beyond this. And so he asks other people to help care for her. Now, the Bible talks about meeting practical needs of our families. For example, it says, 1 Timothy, it says, show respect for widows who really are all alone. But if a widow has children or grandchildren, and he's talking about those that are in the church, he says, they should learn first to carry out their religious duties toward their family, circle religious duties. If you have a family, you have religious duties. You might not have realized that. And in this way, in other words, caring for the practical needs of your family, we repay our parents and grandparents because that is what pleases God. So if you want to please God, you take care of your elderly mother. You take care of your elderly father. You help them out. And especially as they get older, I mean, and with people living longer and longer these days, more and more of us have elderly parents that we can help in some way. Love really begins at home. It says, if anyone does not provide for his relatives, in 1 Timothy, and especially for his immediate family, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. So that's pretty serious. He's saying, hey, it's important. You know, your family. Some of you might have older parents and their memory is getting worse. Maybe they have dementia and, you know, and they ask you something 15 times, and when you show patience to them, you're loving Jesus in that way. You're loving on them. My stepfather, he passed away a few years ago now, But he died of Alzheimer's. And when it first was diagnosed and then the symptoms started coming, it was really hard on our family, particularly my mom. And all of her kids really did not live, and we grew up in Tucson, and we all moved away, except for one brother who has a mental illness. And so she was in a real tough spot, especially for several years. And so all of my sister, my other two brothers, we kind of got together. We said, let's all take turns flying in. And so we all decided to fly to Tucson three times a year for about a week. That would mean that she would have one of us there at least once a month for a week. And we were, you know, in a month, if you have a whole week, you can do a lot. You know, I'd work around the house. We'd take her to the doctor, take my stepfather to the doctor, all get prescriptions, just all kinds of things. And be there for her, you know, for her emotional support as well. That's, you know, it looks different for everybody, wouldn't you say? I mean, everybody's going to go through, nobody's going to have the same situation. But you look for ways that you can help meet the needs of your family, because it's one of the ways that we demonstrate love, and then by giving emotional support. Now, Mary, you know, is very brokenhearted, and this is a very tender scene between Jesus, because he knows how brokenhearted she is. She's actually had a life of emotional pain. If you really think about it, I mean, from the very beginning, she finds out she's pregnant. She's never had, the Bible says she's a virgin. She's never had sex with a person. She's engaged, but she's never met Joseph. And she certainly never had sex with him. And so she has to travel down to tell him that, I know we're engaged, but I'm pregnant. But don't worry, I've never slept with somebody. And by the way, this baby's God. You know, I mean, how's that going to go over? It doesn't go over well. He thinks to himself, I don't believe her. I think she's lying. And then God speaks to Joseph. But she still has to come back and live in her small town in Nazareth. Joseph is, his hometown is Bethlehem. And so she comes back and she's there and having to endure all of the ridicule of her and the shame in her hometown. That's tough. Then the baby's born and she goes to Jerusalem and to dedicate Jesus. And there's a man there, a priest, Simeon, who dedicates him and blesses Jesus. And then pulls Mary off to the side and says, hey, by the way, I have a word for you. This baby is going to grow up and suffer tremendously, horrible pain. And also, you will have horrible pain. And you'll be pierced through the heart through all of this. Have a good day now. You know, I mean, just like, whoa, I'm a new parent. How'd you like that as a new parent? That'd be tough. Then she has the baby and they end up living in Joseph's hometown in Bethlehem. And Herod, who's the king of Palestine, decides he hears about the Messiah thing. He decides he doesn't want a competitor. So he decides to murder him. He doesn't know who he is. So he just says, murder all of the kids 2 years old or younger. So she flees, goes to a foreign land, but then she knows, she carries the emotional pain of knowing that all of those children in Bethlehem were killed because of her kid. Then she ends up going to Nazareth and living there. Jesus gets older and Jesus starts his ministry. And the people in Nazareth where Jesus was from, they don't like it. Even though he did miracles, even though he raised people from the dead, they get so angry at Jesus, they try to throw him off a cliff in Nazareth. And then that's where Mary's living. I mean, how'd you like to try to get along with your neighbors after they tried to throw your son off a cliff? You know, it's hard to invite them over for lunch, right? I mean, just, I'm still struggling with this, you know? I mean, you weren't very nice. And then, of course, Jesus is crucified. And John's experiencing emotional turmoil as well. I mean, he knows he's the Son of God, but he doesn't understand it all. Why does he have to be brutalized? Why does he have to be tortured like this? Why is he crucified like this? And so they're in all of this emotional pain, and Jesus, see, he's connecting with them. He's saying, you know, and there's this exchange of here, when Jesus was a baby, he leaned on Mary. When John became a disciple, he leaned on Jesus. And now he's saying, I want you to lean on each other. I want you to care for one another. He's meeting their emotional needs. They're giving emotional support. Proverbs 17 says, Friends love through all kinds of weather, and families stick together in all kinds of trouble. So this is something we take away from. This is what Jesus certainly did. And we do that when our kids are going through a tough time. Do you just say suck it up, or do you Do you look for ways to give emotional support? You know, hey, I'm going to stand there with you. I'm going to pray with you. I'm going to get in the boat with you. And that's one of the ways we learn how to love. And learning to love is primarily starts not just at work or even in a ministry at church. It happens at home. Second, I must treat other believers as my family. So now we're kind of going a little deeper. See, there's a lot of people that care for their families, but they may be doing it for selfish reasons. They might be thinking, I'm going to just take care of my own and the rest of the world can go to hell. I'm not worried about them. I'm just going to be worried about, I'm concerned about my own family. But the Bible says that we're supposed to care for God's family. That there's a greater family. When you become a Christ follower, you all of a sudden get adopted into a bigger family that you're part of. And see, any unbeliever can just care for their own family, but as believers, we're to care for God's family. God says, I've got a family too, and you're part of it now. You're part of it. And to recognize that. See, physical families can end for all kinds of reasons. People move, people transition, people divorce, people die, all kinds of things. But your spiritual family, they're forever, forever. And so it's a real family that we belong to. And so that's something that when we're recognizing what it means to be part of the family of God, there's that saying, blood is thicker than water, and that's true, but grace is thicker than genetics. You know, we're part of something bigger, and we help one another. So Matthew 12:50 says, whoever does the will of my Father, Jesus is talking in heaven, is my brother and my sister and my mother. So that makes us related. He says that when you follow Christ, you're part of this family. And then 1 Timothy says, do not rebuke an older man, he's talking about in the church, but appeal to him as your father. Treat the younger men in the church as your brothers. Treat the older women in the church as your mothers, and treat the younger women in the church as sisters with all purity. So that means that I have brothers right here in this church. I've a number of brothers. I have a number of sisters in this church. And I have fathers. I have men that have really been walking with the Lord longer than me. The one thing I don't seem to have is any spiritual mothers, because no women I know want to be referred to as older. You know, an older woman. So I have a lot of sisters. Some of them are up there in age, but they're sisters, right? We're family. And there's something powerful that happens when we realize it. See, that's part of the transformation that happens. When somebody receives Christ, they begin a path. And they go, I don't understand what this means. But I feel better. My conscience is starting, God's starting to clear my conscience. I'm experiencing a new way when I look at the Bible. It makes sense to me in ways it didn't. And then it's a slow progression. And then we go, oh, I need to be water baptized. And somewhere along, something needs to unlock in each one of us and realize, oh, this is not just church. This is my church family. This is family. And when we understand that, that's when we start realizing the need, oh, I need to get to know them. I need to open myself up. I'm not going to be able to know everybody. That's why a small group is so important, where a group can connect. I can connect with and I can be there for them, and they can be there with me. You know, so he says there's older and there's younger. In other words, there's going to be older people that we help and care for. There's going to be younger people that we mentor. That is an intergenerational church. Churches that all have the same age, they can't do this. But in churches that are intergenerational, and sometimes people come in the church and they see so many young people, because we do, God's blessed us with a lot of young people. They go, wow, there's so many young people. I'm just looking for friends. Well, that's not what the Bible talks about. See, this isn't my idea. God says it's his idea that we're supposed to mentor younger people, and we're looking to support and care for older people. Says, be devoted to one another. Romans 12:10 says, be devoted to each other like a loving family. Excel in showing respect for one another. Excel. You know, I want to point something out that's kind of interesting. Here Jesus is on the cross, And he has John take care of his mom. Now, he has options because I don't know if you know this, but Jesus has half-brothers. He has four half-brothers. He has at least two half-sisters because Joseph and Mary ended up having children. Now, Jesus was born from Mary as a virgin. The Holy Spirit came upon her. But Joseph ended up, they got married and had children, a number of kids. They're actually named in the Bible. One of them is James. He's the author of one of the books in the Bible. So why didn't Jesus on the cross just say, look at one of the, you know, the sisters, or go up to, you know, one of the brothers, hey, take care of mom. Take care of mom. Well, the reason he didn't do it is because the Bible says at that time they were not believers. They weren't believers. John 7:5 says none of them had become believers yet. And now eventually they did become believers. James, like I said, ended up writing one of the books. He ended up becoming a church leader in Jerusalem. But it was probably hard for them. Could you imagine growing up and Jesus is one of your siblings and he's perfect? I mean, really perfect. Never does anything wrong. Doesn't cheat and checkers or anything. So anytime you tell mom, mom, it's Jesus, she's going to go, we both know it's not Jesus, you know. That's got to irritate, you know. I probably wouldn't believe either. But after he does the miracles and then he raises from the dead and I see him walking around, I'd believe at that point. And so later on they become believers. But see, he gives charge to his disciple John because he's a mature believer. Now, we're supposed to give special attention to our church family. It says, Galatians 6:10, whenever we have the opportunity to help anyone, we should do it. But we should give special attention to those who belong to the family of believers. And so one of the things we're to do is give emotional support. Galatians 6:2 says, share each other's troubles and problems, and in this way obey the law of Christ. Now, how can we do this if we don't really get to know each other? Here comes my sermon on small groups. We need to be in small groups because in a small group is where people learn about who you are and what your needs are. And if you've got something going on, you got a court case coming or a job situation or a health crisis, all kinds of things. If you don't know anybody, how can we be there for you? I've had people come up to me and they go, Andy, you know, I'm upset at you. I'm upset at this church. I say, why? Oh, because I went through this time in my life and nobody reached out to me. Or, you know, I had so-and-so, you know, parent, you know, get sick or pass away and nobody called me. I said, well, did you tell us? Well, no, I'm not in a small group or anything. Well, how would we know? Well, I put it on Facebook. And that's somehow, I mean, I'm supposed to read all your Facebook posts and that's how I would know? How do people know? Well, so the only way we can obey this command is by letting people in. Letting people in, sharing your story, letting them talk to you. Because you know what? It's good for both. It's good for both. Number three, learn to see others' pain even when I'm in pain. Now, this is super hard. I mean, each one's harder, but this one's, I mean, when I'm in pain, I'm only thinking about me. I'm very self-centered when I'm in pain. I don't know about you. When I'm vomiting and I have diarrhea at home, I'm not thinking, I wonder how the church is doing. You know, I mean, that doesn't come in. I wonder what's going on. I wonder what ministry. I wonder how that ministry is. No, I'm consumed with myself. When I've gone through surgery and I'm in pain, I just want to be pampered. I want to be babied. I want Sharon to come with a little feather duster and just give me some grapes, even peel the skin off. Right? Is that only me? No, I think all of us, when we're in pain, right, we just clam up, we just get all self-focused. But when we look at Jesus, he's being crucified. He's in extraordinary pain, and yet he is still recognizing the pain of people around him. You know, he sees the crowd. They've kind of gotten into this frenzy. They've crucified the Messiah. He sees their guilt, and then he says, Father, forgive them. He's addressing the pain of guilt, which is a lot of dysfunctional stuff happens because of guilt. He addresses that. He sees a criminal. He's a murderer. And earlier, he just mocked him. And he sees the pain of this guy facing eternity separated from God, and he addresses that. And he says, you know, he says, today you'll be with me in paradise. Then he sees the pain of his best friend and his mom. And he addresses that. Even though he's in pain. He could have easily just said, hey, I'm in so much pain. I can't do two things, man. I mean, I'm all consumed with my own self right now. See, when we're in pain, if we allow God to use that pain, it'll actually sensitize us, because it's to be more sensitive, more aware of other people's pain. Sometimes when we're not in pain, we're really not aware. And then when people talk about their pain, we're just like, oh, can you kind of get through that real quick? You're kind of killing the mood, you know? I mean, you're robbing my joy. That comes from somebody who's not connecting. See, they're not in pain. But when you're in pain, it's a different animal. I mean, totally different experience. You see other people's pain, or you're more likely to, if you allow God to help you with that. And so Jesus does that. And the Bible says your attitude should be the same as that of Jesus Christ. In other words, you look around and you look for the pain in other people's life. There's other people that are in pain. It's not just you. And then you can be used by the Lord to help with that. It says, since Christ suffered and underwent pain, in 1 Peter 4:1, says you must have the same attitude as he did. You must be ready to suffer too. For remember, when your body suffers, sin loses its power. In other words, you take the pain that you have and you use it for God's glory. It loses, somehow something happens and the pain becomes like pain with meaning. You know, one of the worst pains of all is meaningless pain. You know, why? You know, why? But when God uses our pain in a redemptive way, we still don't get all the whys, but all of a sudden our pain has a purpose. And God starts using our pain. And some of the painful things I've had in my life, God has used those more than anything else. Over the years where I've been able to comfort other people, counsel other people, talk to other people, be compassionate with other people, be more sensitive, be more aware, all those things, because God, use me. I don't want this pain just to, but the tendency is to bury the pain, to just say, I'm not going to bother people with this. I'm not going to talk about it. And maybe the pain is connected to shame and other things. And then we think, I don't want to talk about this. But unfortunately, when that happens, it doesn't lose its power over us. And then number four, meet others' needs even when mine aren't met. This is probably the most difficult of all. Even though my needs, my personal needs, my needs at home, my needs at work, my financial needs, my health needs, even though those are not met, I'm still going to go out of my way and meet other people's needs. And, I mean, Jesus did this. He could have said, I can't meet your needs. Excuse me, I'm being crucified. No, he sees the needs of others. And he goes, even though my needs are not met, I'm going to, because he didn't, you know, he was not, that was not the funnest place to be on the cross. You know, Jesus, it's amazing, because what he did there was the most important work that anybody will ever do. I mean, follow me with this. On the cross, he was dying for the sins of humanity. He was giving reconciliation from humanity to God. People who were apart from God, they could be reconciled and have peace with God and have a new eternity laid out for them. There's nothing more important than what he was doing right there. And yet, he took the time. He could have said, hey, I'm doing something way more important. No, he took the time to meet the needs of other people. Now listen, I know people, I've talked to people, to leaders, pastors, who are saving the world and they're ignoring their family. They're saving the world and they're ignoring the needs of people right close to them. Listen, if you've got a big deal that's so important and you can't address the needs of people that are near you and your small group and your family, you're too busy. That deal's not that important. Nothing you or I do will ever be more important than what Jesus was doing when he was saving the world. And he found time to meet other people's needs. He could have said, oh, that's lowly, man. In the scope of big things, that's not a big deal. Well, no, that's not the way God looks at it. Again, I said, you know, we need God's help for this. But when first thing we recognize it, and then we say, God, help me to address this. Now, what I'm talking about, what we see in Scripture, is the opposite of what we have in the American culture. In American culture, if you're an important individual, you don't have to help somebody else out. I mean, nobody would expect if I was broken down, or you were broken down on the side of the street with a flat tire and Warren Buffett drove by, or Elon Musk, nobody would expect them to pull over and change, help you change your tire, right? That's the world's values. That's American values. But in God's kingdom, to be a leader is to be a servant. That's what it means. Jesus said that in his kingdom, he goes, leaders are servants. And he demonstrated that by washing the disciples' feet and demonstrated that by serving and on the cross and in his whole ministry. In our church, we say when you become a leader, you take on a servant's towel to care for other people. That's what it means. And so that's walking out kingdom values, Christian values. Last verse, Romans 15 says, each one of us needs to look after the good of people around us, asking ourselves, how can I help? Now, if you want to see Jesus today or this week, here's the fast track. The easiest way to see Jesus is look for him disguised in a hurting person. That's where he's at, disguised in a person who's experiencing pain in their life. Now, the good news is there's a lot of hurting and a lot of hurting people. There's a lot of people in pain. And so there's a lot of opportunity to see Jesus. So you look for somebody. Look for them. They might be at the break room on Monday morning. They might be getting gas next to you or getting in the shopping lane behind you. They might be a parent at a soccer game. If you just look, say, God, show me somebody in pain. Show me somebody who's hurting. I want to be used to help them. And watch what God does. He will transform things. I want to just summarize with three things that I want you to just take away. Number one is that God does care about your pain. I mean, from this passage, we see he cares about you. He cares about your pain. Number two, you need to be willing to receive care from other people who want to love on you. There's some of us, maybe many of us, that when we're in pain, we just close off. We shut ourselves in. We don't want to talk about it. We don't want to be a bother. We don't want to open ourselves up. How can you get ministered to? How can you let people in? How can you get your healing if you don't let people in? It's one of the reasons why we have the Connect cards that you're given as you come in. And we say each week, hey, write down your prayer requests. Write down something we can pray for you about so that we know. And then put them in the offering. Put them in the clear boxes that are on the wall. We ask you to come up and say, hey, why don't you come up and receive prayer? You know, we have people up here that'll pray for you. We have small groups. We say we want to be people that connect as a family. We care. It's no bother. That's what families do. And then thirdly, look for an opportunity to care for somebody else who's in a place of need. It's part of the way God uses our pain. Redemptively, gives meaning to it, and it's part of the way that God also brings healing. Let's bow our heads and pray. Now, as we close in prayer, we're just going to take a moment here. And I think it's noteworthy to point out that John, the Apostle John and Mary were at the foot of the cross. They were near Jesus. That's why they received that blessing. That's why they received that special word. They were near Jesus. If they had not been there, they would have missed out. Now listen, God wants to talk to you. He wants to bring his power and his love, expand your love bandwidth. And it happens at the foot of the cross. It happens when you draw near to him. And so I'm inviting you right now to draw near to Christ. Draw near to God. He does care about you. He cares about what your situation is. And if you're in pain today, I want to say, I'm sorry about that. I don't even probably know what it is, but I'm sorry. But let me tell you, God cares about it. He cares about you. You're not just a number. Dear Lord, there are many people in pain today. Some of them are here, but there's people all over that are in pain. Lord, we want to care about them the way you do. Help us to remember, Lord, that you care about our pain. Thank you, Lord, for these lessons that you're giving us as you were dying on the cross in those dying moments. Would you pray now? I want you to just take a moment. Just pray in your mind. You say, Lord, thank you for caring about my pain. I don't want to wallow in it, but I do want to draw near to you. Help me to receive love from others. Would you pray that? That's a courageous prayer, because that means there's an action step associated with it. Help me, Lord, to receive love from others and to offer help to others. I want to learn how to really love, not shallow love, plastic love, artificial. I want the real stuff. Say, Lord, this week, help me to pay attention to the people around me that are in need. Help me to look for ways to give, to pay attention, to give physical help, emotional support. And most of all, Lord, would you say, God, thank you for dying on the cross for me to solve my greatest pain of all, eternal separation from you. Thank you, Lord, that I can know without a doubt my eternity is secured when I put my faith in you because of what you did on the cross. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.